Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Can't tell you how good it is to see everybody out there this morning. We extend a sincere welcome this morning to our Savior Lutheran Church, Nokomis. What a week it has been. What a week it has been. Can I have a show of hands as to how many actually have power now? Oh, I'm jealous. Jealous. I was thinking it would be the other way, but they're out working on it. I'm sure we'll have some patience and give them time to get it fixed again. There's nothing so humbling as the roar of those terrible winds as they passed over us. We do thank God that you're all here today, and a special welcome to those joining on our YouTube channel this morning. I'm sure that each of us has our own Ian story this year, but damages done to our church building were fairly minor, and we're already working on them to get them repaired. We've worked quickly to address the main issues, such as the tree that was laying on our roof and roof repair. That's why you're coming in the side door. By the way, while I'm mentioning that, please enjoy the fellowship hour after church, but walk outside and enjoy the warm air first, the beautiful Florida sunshine first, so you don't have to go through the narthex, because we have a little bit of problem with the ceiling kind of hanging. So I don't want anyone to get hurt. Pastor and I had many conversations this past week in regards to having a service, having it in the fellowship hall, having it in the sanctuary itself. We had some damage done over in that corner with flooding, and we were able to dry it out. The church didn't smell as badly as it did a couple of days ago. So thanks to Norm for lending us a wet-dry vac and for the fans that did their job. But we did get it. We felt we needed some normalcy this week. We need us to come back to some form of normalcy, and this little sanctuary that we have here is our normalcy. So it's, again, great to see you here. And of course, a friendly reminder to please put your cell phones in silent mode. Flowers at the altar today are placed by Mae Hazelton in celebration of what would have been her 58th wedding anniversary with her late husband, Jim Hazelton, who we all dearly miss. Thank you, Mae. As you can imagine, there are many ways that we can help with disaster relief after Ian. Gifts to those suffering from the storm can be made to our church, indicating the gift is for hurricane relief, and we will work with through our Florida Synod to make certain that the disaster relief funds get distributed as needed to the people that are in a lot worse shape than we are up here in the Sarasota area. Next Saturday, a reminder that at 10 a.m., we will be holding the Blessing of the Animals service in our parking lot. Please bring your cats, dogs, rats, and snails, by the way. Thank you, Pastor. Parrots and gerbils for a blessing. Can you also bring along some pet food in cans or bags and or a cash offering that will be, I'm sure, thankfully received by a local pet shelter that we will be donating it to. In addition, our choir will begin rehearsals on Sunday morning, October 16th at 9:15 a.m. They will be singing for us on October 30th. For the first time for the fall, and as I've said last week, new voices are always welcome. There will be fellowship time after church this morning. Please come. You'll need to walk outside, as I said earlier, to get to the fellowship hall, and we'd love to hear some of the Ian stories. I'm sure there's some funny ones out there that you could tell us. I'm sure there's some sad ones also. But again, it's good to see your faces this morning. I was asked by Mary Lou to remind everyone that the women in the Our Savior Lutheran Book Club invite the gentlemen this time in our congregation to join our meeting on this coming Wednesday, October 5th, to hear a conversation about Elizabeth Friedman, the woman who smashed codes in two world wars and during Prohibition. This meeting will be held in the Fellowship Hall at 1:30 p.m. on Wednesday, October 5th. As I said, those attending are welcome to bring a snack, a sandwich, and a beverage to enjoy the presentation. Again, it's for women and men. I guess you've been getting mostly women in the previous book clubs. So come on along. Are there any other announcements? Now it's time to prepare our hearts and our minds, and to invite God's Holy Spirit to inspire us. Please listen to our prelude, The Old Rugged Cross. Thank you, Bobby.
Thank you, Bobby. That, of course, was My Faith Looks Up to Thee. Such a beautiful song for a weekend like this one, too. Rugged Cross would have been good, but I like the one you picked. Join with me, please, now on the order for confession and forgiveness. It's found on page 2 in your bulletin. We're going to do pretty much the same liturgical service that we do every Sunday. And I thought about cutting parts of it off because it's such a strange and amazing time in our lives to have gone through what we just went through this past week. But I thought that we need ritual. We need things to kind of be the same in order to kind of remind us that, hey, we're here. We're supposed to keep going. We're supposed to keep embracing life. So please join me on the confession and forgiveness. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. God of all mercy and consolation, come to the help of your people, turning us from our sin to live for you alone. Give us the power of your Holy Spirit that we may confess our sin, receive your forgiveness, and grow into the fullness of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Gracious God, have mercy on us. We confess that we have turned from you and given ourselves into the power of sin. We are truly sorry and humbly repent. In your compassion, forgive us our sins, known and unknown, things we've done and things we have failed to do. Turn us again to you and uphold us by your Spirit, so that we may live and serve you in newness of life, through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for you, and for his sake forgives you all your sins. As a called and ordained minister of the Church of Christ, and by his authority, I therefore declare to you the entire forgiveness of all your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let's sing verses 1 and 4 of God is Here.
Thank you.
now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
In peace, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord. For this holy house, and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord. Amen. Benevolent, merciful God, when we are empty, fill us. When we are weak in faith, strengthen us. When we are cold in love, warm us, that with fervor we may love our neighbors and serve them. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Our first lesson is from Habakkuk 1, the oracle that the prophet Habakkuk saw. O Lord, how long shall I cry for help, and when you will not listen? Or cry to you violence, and you will not save? Why do you make me see wrongdoing and look at trouble? Destruction and violence are before me. Strife and contention arise. So the law becomes slack, and justice never prevails. The wicked surround the righteous, therefore judgment comes forth perverted. I will stand at my watchpost and station myself on the rampart. I will keep watch to see what he will say to me and what he will answer concerning my complaint. Then the Lord answered and said, write the vision, make it plain on tablets, so that a runner may read it. For there is still a vision for the appointed time. It speaks of the end and does not lie. If it seems to tarry, wait for it. It will surely come. It will not delay. Look at the proud. Their spirit is not right in them, but the righteous live by their faith. The word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
Our psalm today is Psalm 37, 1 through 9. Do not fret because of those who are evil, or be envious of those who do wrong. For like the grass, they will soon wither. Like green plants, they will soon die away. Trust in the Lord and do good. Dwell in the land and enjoy safe pasture. Take delight in the Lord, and he will give you the desires of your heart. Commit your way to the Lord. Trust him, and he will do this. He will make your righteous reward shine like the dawn, your vindication like the noonday sun. Be still before the Lord and wait patiently for him. Do not fret when people succeed in their ways, when they carry out their wicked schemes. Refrain from anger and turn from wrath. Do not fret, it leads only to evil. For those who are evil will be destroyed, but those who hope in the Lord will inherit the land. Thank you, Bobby. Our second reading is from 2 Timothy 1. Paul, an apostle of Christ Jesus by the will of God, according to the promise of the life, to Timothy, my beloved child, grace, mercy, and peace from God the Father and Christ Jesus our Lord. I thank God whom I serve, as did my ancestors, with a clear conscience, as I remember you constantly in my prayers night and day. As I remember your tears, I long to see you, that I may be filled with joy. I am reminded of your sincere faith, a faith that dwelt first in your grandmother Lois and your mother Eunice, and now I am sure dwells in you also well. For this reason, I remind you to fan into flame the gift of God, which is in you through the laying on of my hands. For God gave us a spirit not of fear, but of power, love, and self-control. Therefore, do not be ashamed of the testimony about our Lord, nor of me, his prisoner, but share in suffering for the gospel by the power of God, who saved us and called to us a holy calling, not because of our works, because of his own purpose and grace, which he gave us in Christ Jesus before the ages began, and which now has been manifested through the appearing of our Savior, Christ Jesus, who abolished death and brought life and immortality to light through the gospel. For which I was appointed a preacher, an apostle, and teacher, which is why I suffer as I do. But I am not ashamed, for I know whom I have believed, and I am convinced that he is able to guard until that day what has been entrusted to me. Follow the pattern of the sound words that you have heard from me, in the faith and love that are in Christ Jesus, by the Holy Spirit who dwells within us, guard the good deposit entrusted to you. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
Alleluia, Lord, to whom shall we go?
The Gospel according to St. Luke, the 17th chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
The apostle said to the Lord, "Increase our faith." The Lord replied, "If you had faith the size of a mustard seed, you could say to this mulberry tree, 'Be uprooted and planted in the sea,' and it would obey you. Who among you would say to your slave who just came in from plowing or tending sheep in the field, 'Come here at once and take your place at the table'? Would you not rather say to him, 'Prepare supper for me, put on your apron and serve me while I eat and drink. Later you may eat and drink.' Do you thank the slave for doing what was commanded? So you also, when you've done all that you were ordered to do, say, 'We are worthless slaves. We have done only what we ought to have done.'" The Gospel of the Lord. You may be seated. Let us pray. I thank you that we can be here this morning, O Lord. And yes, the roar of those winds still echo in my mind as I think about how fierce nature can be to us and how many are suffering all along the path of Hurricane Ian. So as we gather here this morning, we just give you thanks above all things that we have a church we can gather in, that we have people who, in spite of probably needing a shower, needing some electricity, are still here this morning to hear the good news. And I pray, Lord, that somehow, some way, there will be just that word for them that they will need to help them to live in a world where there are so many things that are uncertain. And we were reminded of that again so plainly in this past week. Help us to live in such a world, keeping our focus, the center of our faith in you. For above all things, and beneath all things, and around all things, there is our blessed Lord, our Savior, our friend Jesus. And it is to you, O Lord, that we pray today. Amen. Some of you may know the song, and I actually was wondering if Betsy was going to come to sing it, but she isn't here. She doesn't have electricity. She doesn't have a shower. And she thought she didn't want to come smelling bad. So you all remember the song, perhaps. It's called "You'll Never Walk Alone." And it's from the musical Carousel, way back in 1946. It was written, Rodgers and Hammerstein. "When you walk through a storm, hold your head up high, and don't be afraid of the dark. At the end of the storm, there's a golden sky and the sweet silver song of a lark. Walk on through the wind, walk on through the rain, though your dreams be tossed and blown. Walk on with hope in your hearts, and you will never walk alone. You will never walk alone." I think a song made just for this past week. Wind, rain, a storm. I admit that I like its encouraging words about the brighter days ahead, about a time when the skies are clear, like today, the sun is shining once more. But this past week has also been a time of great testing. And no show tune can make this mess all better. Maybe more than anything else, nature has a way at ripping at our faith. How, oh God, could you let this happen? How is the world so tossed and turned by human error? And on top of that, you add the ways that nature challenges us to survive in an ever-increasing hostile environment. There are a lot of people up and down the state of Florida wondering how this could happen if God is good, benevolent, caring, and always at our side. So I'm with the disciples this morning, and as you heard me read the gospel lesson, the first thing they say to him, maybe they'd just been through some kind of a storm, and they say loud and clear, "Lord, increase our faith." I heard this past week about a family living in the evacuation part of our city, They read all the early predictions about where the real fury of the storm was going to hit, and guess what they decided to do? To evacuate to Fort Myers. Not a good idea. Oh Lord, increase our faith. And when the electrical wires are hopelessly tangled in the downed trees all along 41, and there's no power, we say again, Lord, increase my faith. I want a faith that can live with all the challenges of this world, that can keep me looking at these blue skies and calm winds and the trees standing tall again. I want a faith that works in all kinds of weather, a faith that sails along with weather storms and laughs and dangers and has plenty of peace to allow me to sleep well at night. Lord, I want that kind of faith. I want a faith that would keep me always kind and loving to strangers. I want to have such a loving, giving heart that I never doubt the ways of nature. I'll give you the shirt off my back and do it with a smile on my face. That's the kind of faith that I want. But instead of giving his disciples the faith pill, the faith tonic, the peace and harmony aromatherapy, instead of this, Jesus says to them, "You have plenty of faith." Yes, you. It is not in short supply. But then why does it feel that way? You have a faith and it's small and you may forget you have it, but it's a tree-moving kind of faith. So I get a call on Friday morning. "Pastor, do you want that tree taken off your church roof? I'll give you a good deal." "But who are you?" "Oh, I'm a tree cutter and I do a good job." But I had heard the warnings. Hadn't we all heard them? There will be scams and liars out there who will try to take advantage of you. But I knew the tree looked awful and it probably was poking a hole in our brand new roof we had just paid $18,000 for. "Well, Pastor, I give you a good deal," he said again. I told him that I'd meet him over here at the church. Now, through the course of this past week, I had read the gospel for this Sunday. A little faith will be enough, it says, to say to the big tree, "Be uprooted and planted in the Gulf of Mexico." Was there a lesson here? So as I approached the parking lot, I saw the snazzy new pickup truck with "tree service" written on the side. A cheerful man named Mark said, "We are here and we'll help you with your tree." Chainsaws were already out of the truck. Three other men were standing beside the guy who had called me. They were all smiling. "We will give you a good deal," he said. So far, my faith had not done the trick. The tree had not moved an inch with all the faith I could muster. I followed Jesus' teaching and I said, "Be uprooted, tree, off the roof of our building and go plant yourself in the sea." No good. And right in front of me was someone who could do that work for me. And so I said, yes. Worst case, I figured, the $600 he was charging me was, if it was way too much, then I'd just pay it out of my own pocket. And so the tree came down. The branches were all gathered together, taken out to the street, and just then, John Klein pulled up. Our congregational president. "Got the tree down, did you, Pastor?" "Does the guy have liability insurance? Does he know what he's doing? Will he further destroy the roof? You know that we have to have insurance and we have to have a contractor who has been bonded before we can do that kind of work on our church." And it was at that time that I recalled a quote that was attributed to none other than Ronald Reagan. You remember the Ronald Reagan quote? "Trust but verify." Yeah. Truth is that Reagan learned the expression from the Russian high-level negotiations he had with Mikhail Gorbachev. And Gorbachev told him, he said, there's an old Russian proverb that says, "Duverye, no proveye," meaning in Russian, trust, but verify. That informs the wise to be sure you have all your facts together before you go out on a limb, excuse the pun, and the gospel ends with a parable about what the people who wait for their faith to do everything for them. And I want to tell you that we got the tree down, and the president is still speaking with me. And the tree has been cut down, but the stump is still there. So I wrestled with the idea of a faith that was supposed to be strong enough that it could take a tree and root it into the ocean. Or there was a guy who'd call me out of the blue and say, "I'll take down your tree," but I had no guarantees. He could have been a real shyster. He could have taken that tree and simply chopped it in half, meaning that all the rest would have toppled onto the roof as well. So I did my best, and John has since forgiven me. Maybe the only way to talk about our faith then is to talk about to trust, but to live in a world that is terribly uncertain. A world where we say, "Lord, increase my faith." And the Lord turns right around and says to me, "You've got enough." It may be just as small, you figure, as a tiny, tiny mustard seed, but it's enough. The faith you have is enough. And so I realize that that's all we all have in the state of Florida right now. Faith that couldn't hold back the storms. Faith that didn't say, "Protect my little house at the expense of that guy over there." That faith is not something that sets us apart because we can just hold up our faith card and we won't have any trouble. "I've got faith, Lord. Spare me trees that fall on my roof." Instead, Jesus says to each of us, "You are going to learn where faith really comes from." What exactly am I asking for when I beg God to give me more faith? Sometimes I think I'm asking for a faith that moves trees just by thinking about it. Supernaturally able to manipulate God into doing what I want. I want to get the tree off the roof and to claim that it was the answer to my prayers as I first got that phone call. I wanted to be able to brag to you all about the fact that I had gotten that tree off the roof by faith alone. Sometimes I'm asking for more faith so that I can be broad enough and understand the confusing things of life. And I say, "Lord, just fix my mind so that I'll be at peace and have faith enough to face this." And sometimes I'm asking for an antidote to my anxiety. "God, please take away the fear I feel as I listen to the storm clouds, as I worry about my kids and my grandchildren," who don't live in Florida, thank God, but they still go through times of great fear. "Rewire my brain, God, and my heart so that it becomes impossible to doubt you ever again." That's what I want when I say, "Give me faith." And Jesus says, "No, you have faith." So what is faith after all? Is it a noun? I need more faith. So I take faith in, or I live with more faith by praying certain prayers or going certain places in a pilgrimage, and I get more faith. Or is faith perhaps really not a noun at all, but a verb? Is faith something that we do then? So we do reach out to our neighbor who's got a big tree across the front driveway and can't get out? Do we check on our neighbors? Is that what faith is? Or is it snapping our fingers and everything turns out for the better? I must admit that when I ask God to increase my faith, what I'm really asking for is something like a spiritual life that's easy, smooth, and uncomplicated. Jesus' response to his disciple, however, suggests that faith requires rigor, that is, muscle and strength. It grows stronger when it's exercised and weakens when it's idle. In other words, Jesus doesn't sidestep the disciples' request for faith out of callousness. He sidesteps it out of wisdom and out of deep love. When he tells them, you have enough faith, the first thing they're going to say is, no, I don't. Lord, I don't have enough faith. And he says, yes, you do. Let's try thinking of faith as a verb. How am I going to have more faith? Well, I'll have more faith by doing. And in a week like this, when we look back over it and we think about the people who have been hurt so deeply, I want to pray for their faith. But I also want to pray for your faith so that you can do what you can in this time to say, I cannot change the circumstances of living in a broken world, but I can change me. And I can take myself and I can walk out of my comfort zone and I can go into my neighbor and I can say, do you have power? Would you like to take a shower at my place? Turn to one another is the kind of faith I think Jesus is offering for. So when he tells this strange parable about a servant doing his master's bidding before the servant gets a chance to sit down and have a meal, what he's trying to say to us is that we are those servants. Our growing in faith happens when we continue to serve the one who gave us life and love, the one who stands on our side and will never desert us. Amen. Confessing our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father, Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Savior, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. As scattered grains of wheat are gathered together into one bread, so let us gather our prayers for the church, those in need, and all of God's creation. We pray for your holy church in every place and for those who are following the example of Christ. Help them to live by faith and walk by the light of your gospel, God of grace.
Amen.
For parts of the world ravaged by natural disaster, relieve those affected by floods, wildfires, droughts, earthquakes, tornadoes and hurricanes, and all along the path of Hurricane Ian. God of grace,
amen.
For every nation and those entrusted with authority, grant our leaders self-discipline in all things and inspire them with love for your people, God of grace. For the victims of violence, abuse, and neglect, heal those who have been harmed and protect those who are vulnerable. For all who are sick, especially Beverly Arnold, Judy Berger, Mercer and Bobby Brown, Joyce Brown, Evelyn Buhner, Lisa Perry Erickson, Chris Etzweiler, Carol and Don Jamitti, John Greger, Cheryl Hogan, Linda Hallfast, Tim Heil, Robin Hinton, Caleb LaGrange, Norman Johnson, Marcy Capsch and her children, Aaron Keyes, Joan Larson, Mike Moberg, Tina McCarthy, June McCarthy, David Plant, Mike and Carrie Richardson, Marilee Smith, Dawn and Scott Sweet, Christine Viscoso, and Ron Weyer, God of grace. For this and every congregation, rekindle your gifts within your people and inspire councils, communities, and individuals to plan and work together that all may know your love. We pray for a peaceful and joyous New Year observance for our Jewish brothers and sisters. God of grace, in thanksgiving that you have abolished death and for the saints who have died, St. Francis of Assisi, Theodore Fligner, William Tyndale, Harry Muhlenberg, especially we continue to seek comfort also for those who have lost their loved ones. May Hazelton, Kathy Smith, John Hazelton, Elaine Ludwig, bring us all to eternal life with you, God of grace. Gather together in the sweet communion of the Holy Spirit, gracious God, we offer these and all our prayers to you through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Well, we need what we're about to do, and that's the peace of those around us. So it's a privilege to have you stand. You may elbow or handshake, but let's feel some of that community. The peace of the Lord be with you all.
And also with you.
Thank you.
us pray, God of all creation, all you have made is good, and your love endures forever. You bring forth bread from the earth and fruit from the vine. Nourish us with these gifts that we might be for the world signs of your gracious presence. In Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty God and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ, who on this day overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. And so with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Beside the sinner, among the poor, with us now.
We thank you, O God.
In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took the bread. He broke it and he gave it to his disciples, and he said, "Take and eat, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again after supper, he took the cup. He gave thanks and gave it to them all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Blessing, praise, and thanks to you, Holy God, through Christ Jesus, by your Spirit, in your church, without end.
Amen.
Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. You may be seated. You are invited to come forth for communion and receive the host. With that, you will simply walk towards Cindy, who will have a chance for you to dip into the chalice full of wine, and then you receive it. And that's how we do communion. You'll be invited to come forward as the ushers invite you.
Thank you. us pray. We give you thanks, Almighty God, that you have refreshed us through the healing power of this gift of life. In your mercy, strengthen us through this gift in faith toward you and in fervent love toward one another. For the sake of Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
We're not going to have the sending forth of communion because we're missing a couple of our communion distributors. So we'll carry that into the second Sunday in October rather than today. Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless you now and forever.
Amen. Amen.
Let us sing together, O Master, let me walk with you.
Peace, Christ is with you.
Thank you.